The content in this week is the continued part from our previous class. We still continue on the root locus design and analysis. From last time we met, we introduced the concept of the root locus when we identify the location of pole and zero of system from the transfer function of the system, the open loop transfer function of the system. We have the pole and the zero, if you still remember, and we plot it on the S plane. Maybe we have transfer function like this. The block diagram gonna be the gain, proportional gain of controller. And we have a transfer function of system. And in the feedback loop, the gain for the feedback, the gain for the feedback is only a constant one. And for the closed loop transfer function, for the closed loop transfer function of a feedback system, maybe we're gonna have the forward part divided by one plus the loop. And the cross loop characteristic equation, we consider the denominator. So the meaning of the root locus means, when we adjust the value of the gain K, how is the root, of this equation deviate from the original point, So the idea is we just consider the open loop transfer function, In this case, the feedback is just only one, but if we have the plan, and if we have the sensor, open loop transfer function here gonna be the plan transfer function multiplied by the sensor transfer function, and the pole and the zero, when we plot the root locus, will be obtained from the product of the transfer function of the plan and the sensor. So from the characteristic equation, and we just consider the open loop transfer function here, we may need to recap. The pole is the root of the denominator. So we may have pole, and we have pole. And we have one zero, The zero may be somewhere. The pole and the zero can be on the real axis, or it can also be complex conjugate, can also be complex conjugate. And maybe from last week, we provide some rules to sketch the root locus. For example, we know that on the real plane, on the real axis, if we have the locus of the root, it should be on the left-hand side of the odd order, pole or zero. Another part that we know is the locus will travel from pole and approach the zero. The locus will travel from pole and approach the zero when we increase the gain k. When gain k is very small, when gain k is very small, the location of the root is on the location of the pole. And when we increase the gain k, the location of the root of this equation, the location of the root of this equation will move, will travel along the locus of the root and approach the zero. If we have the number of pole more than the number of zero, the locus from one pole will approach the zero and another one will go to infinite, will go to infinite. And it's gonna go to the infinite in which direction depend on the asymptote, depend on the asymptote. Maybe the asymptote can be in the minus 180 degrees or in the negative real axis, or asymptote can be have the intersection point and have 60 degrees, have 180 degrees and minus 60 degrees. Asymptote may be like this. Depend on the different number of pole and number of zero. So please review about the asymptote. Today in one example, we also have a review about the asymptote. And from next week, we have several examples talking about the asymptote. Asymptote means maybe if we have the pole here and we don't have zero in the system, we don't have zero in the system. The two pole, if we have three asymptote, if we have three asymptote means the number of pole should be three, the number of zero should be zero, and we're gonna have three asymptote. Have three pole maybe. One pole may go to the minus real axis. Another two pole maybe go along another two asymptotes. The first thing we need to find is to define the axis that all the asymptotes cross or intersect the real axis. Another point for the asymptote is the angle of the asymptote. But the angle of the asymptote is not that difficult. The angle of the asymptote can be something that can be divided by 180 degrees. It may be plus and minus 90 degree asymptote, plus and minus 90 degree asymptote, or maybe 180 and minus 60 degree. I never see, in my experience, I never see asymptote more than three lines. But by the definition and by math, we can have more than three asymptotes. But based on my experience, the maximum number of asymptotes, just only three asymptotes. Angle of departure and angle of arrival. Angle of departure means when the gain increase, the locus of the root is moving away from the pole location. Angle of departure is this angle. And angle of arrival, if we have a zero somewhere here, and the pole location need to arrive at the pole, at the zero location, we're gonna have the angle of arrival. Angle of departure and angle of arrival are obtained from the angular criteria of the root locus. So if you review the previous lecture, you're gonna understand these three bullets. But for today, what we are going to continue is when the locus approach asymptote, if it is going to cross the imaginary axis, at this point and at its complex conjugate, this point, what is the gain k that make the root locus cross the imaginary axis? Why this is important? Because we're gonna know that when we increase the gain k to some value, the system gonna move from the stable region to unstable. If we increase the gain k, the root move from the pole and go follow the asymptote. But when we increase the gain k to a certain value, the root locus gonna cross the imaginary axis. The real part gonna switch from the negative to positive real part. At that point, the system will turn to unstable. So the intersection point of the root locus and the imaginary axis is important, because we're gonna know that the limitation of k that we can increase. Another bullet is the breakaway and break in. We know that if we have two poles on the real plane, on the real axis, when we increase the gain, the locus gonna move. We're gonna have the locus line between the on the left side of the odd order of the pole or zero on the real plane. And we're not gonna have the root locus here, because pole number two is even number. The root locus gonna be on the left hand side of order one, order three. And when it come and it hit with each author another locus line, it's gonna create the breakaway point. When it hit, one locus will go upper, or go above the real axis. Another locus will go to the downward direction. Here is the breakaway point. The gain k that the locus begin to move away from the real axis. Move away from the real axis by physical meaning means it's gonna create vibration. It's gonna create vibration. If the root of the system is on the real axis, we only see the exponential decay. We only see the exponential decay. But when we have complex conjugate, when we have complex conjugate, the system will begin to vibrate. If it stay far from the real axis, if it stay far from the real axis, the damping ratio is equal to the cosine of this angle, of this angle. If it stay far from the real axis, the vibration will be more extreme, will be more extreme. And we already have the breakaway point. Of course, the locus should approach the zero. But for the zero on the real plane, the locus cannot just approach the zero in this way. It cannot just go and approach the zero like this. It needs to have some point that it arrives the real axis. At this point, we call the break-in. Break-in. Break-in point and breakaway. Breakaway. So today, the prod technique, we're gonna continue with these two bullets. And I will try to add the MATLAB code. So now, from the beginning of this chapter, in last class and in today class, I try to teach you the sketching method for the root locus, but we have computer tools. You just need to understand concept. You just need to understand concept. But if you're lazy to do it by hand, of course, we have computational tools. And we're gonna have a little more time to talk about the application of root locus for the design of controller, design the gain for proportional controller, design the gain for PD controller in order to have the system with a desired behavior. When the root locus will intersect the imaginary axis. Maybe in this system, the pole one is equal to zero. Pole two maybe minus two plus okay. Maybe there is something wrong here. In this one should be four. This one should be four. So pole one is equal to zero. Pole two may be minus four plus four J, and pole three may be minus four minus four J. And in this system, we don't have zero. We don't have zero. We don't have zero because we don't have S on the numerator. So when we plot the pole location on the S plane, pole equal to zero and minus four plus four J, minus four J. We have three pole. And when we obtain the asymptote, when we obtain the asymptote, there are three asymptotes. And the intersection point is here. The first asymptote makes 60 degrees with the real axis. Another one makes 180 degrees. And another one have minus 60 degrees. I already asked you a question that we know that the asymptote gonna cross the imaginary axis, but the real locus of the root, the real locus of the root, it gonna cross the imaginary axis somewhere. And at some point of gain K, this locus will cross the imaginary axis. And at the same gain K, the complex conjugate also gonna cross this imaginary axis. So when we talk about stability and talk about the cross the imaginary axis, every time we need to talk about the route stability criteria. So from this characteristic equation, how can we transform the equation into the form that we can apply the route stability criteria? It seems like now we have 1 plus K per S and multiply by S square plus S plus 16 and plus 16 equal to 0. So it means that we have S power 3 plus 8 S power 2 and plus 32 S plus K equal to 0. The route stability criteria, we take the polynomial on the denominator of the correct of the closed loop transfer function. If you review the route stability, we consider the G closed loop and equal to num divided by den. And then it's polynomial. So this polynomial equal to 0 for the then for the characteristic equation is the way we construct the route array. When we construct the route array, we begin from S power 3, S power 2, S power 1, and S power 0. And the coefficient 1, 8, 32, and K. In this position, B1 is equal to minus K subtract by 256 and divide by 8. This is B1. So the value of B1 may be 32 minus K per 8, Of course, the other component is gonna be 0. So B2 gonna be zero, gonna be zero. How about C1? C1 in this position. C1 is equal to minus of k multiplied by the no, I'm sorry, it's 32. C1 is equal to minus of k multiplied by 32 subtract by k per x and divide by, so it's not difficult for C1, it's not difficult for C1, the value gonna be minus k. The system gonna be stable. The system gonna be stable when all of this positive. The system gonna be stable if all of these are positive. I think I did something wrong here. C1 is equal to minus. Okay. The downward gonna be positive. The upward gonna be negative. C1 is equal to minus of zero subtract by k multiplied by this parent and divide by this. So C1 is equal to k. C1 is equal to k, not minus k. So the system gonna be stable when the first column of the row array or the component in the first column of the row array are positive. K is positive. 32 minus K per X also positive, which means the K should be less than, the K should be less than 256. So in this case, when we increase the K to 256, the locus of the root gonna cross the imaginary axis. Gonna cross the imaginary axis. But what is the value? What is the value on the S plane? What is the value of the S plane? S1 and S2. What is the value? What is the value on the S plane? So now we know the K value. We know the K value when it crosses the imaginary axis. When we need to obtain the value of the S at that point, we just substitute K back into the original equation. It can be this equation or can be this equation. If we use K equal to 256, what we have is S power 3 plus 8s power 2 plus 32s plus 256 equal to 0. And we solve for the value of s. The order of the equation, the order of polynomial is the third order. So we're going to have three root that relate to the k equal to 256. Two root gonna be S1 and S2 when the locus of the first root and the second root cross the imaginary axis. Another one gonna be when k equal to 256, the root of this pole, the root of this pole gonna be somewhere along the real axis. When we define the value of k here, the root of this equation is gonna be S1, S2, and S3. And with respect to the root, with respect to the pole, p equal to 0, and this complex conjugate pole. So S squared multiplied by S plus 8 and 32 multiplied by S plus 8 equal to 0. S squared plus 32 S plus 8 equal to 0. This may be S squared minus J square root 32 square S plus 8. And we have S minus J of 4 S plus J of 4 square root 2 and S plus 8 equal to 0. So finally, the root of this equation, the position of the root gonna be minus 8 and plus 4 square root 2 J and minus 4 square root 2 J. The minus 8 gonna be this one along the real axis. And another 2 gonna be the position of the root at the intersection point between the locus and the imaginary axis. When it crosses the imaginary axis, of course the real value, the real part gonna be 0. And have only the complex part. So to sum up, in this slide, you use the Rao stability criteria to find the gain K, that the root locus gonna intersect the imaginary axis. And when you use that gain K, you can solve for the root when the locus cross the imaginary axis. And the meaning of this is the k that make the system unstable, and the gain k maybe before it get unstable, it gonna reflect of course the damping ratio gonna be nearly 0 at this point, maybe no meaning no meaning for obtaining an S. Just have the benefit to the sketch of the root locus, but the physical meaning for S1 and S2, in my opinion, is not the important thing. Not the important thing. Yeah. By the way, we can use computational tools to plot this. At the end of today's class, you will see. You will see. The breakaway point. The breakaway point. The breakaway point. Okay. Let's see this one first. How can we sketch? How can we sketch the root locus of this open loop transfer function? How can we sketch the root locus of this open loop transfer function? We should have three pole. We should have three pole. But I don't know the value of the pole. We can have S and S square plus 8S plus 32. S equal to 0 and S equal to 4 and divide by 2, right? Is this correct? Minus 8 plus minus square root 64 minus 4ac divided by 2 should be. We have three pole. We have three pole. No. No. What I do? The root for this gonna be okay. Yeah, I just confused, but actually this system is the same. Actually this system is the same with the previous slide. I just confused with my example, but we should continue. You see this? Actually, okay, actually the plot for the root locus here gonna be the same plot as the previous slide, but I show this example for one reason. before we plot the root locus, we should come back to the idea of the breakaway point first. The idea of the breakaway point means maybe if we have two pole on the real axis, if we have two pole on the real axis, and the locus of the root is on the left hand side of the first pole, of the first pole, when it hit with each other, it's gonna, if we have two pole, we may have, if we have two pole without the, if we have two pole without zero, if we have two pole without zero, we're gonna have two asymptote. We're gonna have two asymptote. The locus will hit with each other at some point and then go along the asymptote, go along the asymptote. In this point, it's easy. It's easy because we know that the asymptote gonna be the position between the two poles, the two poles. And in some case, when the asymptote is not 90 degree, asymptote is not 90 degree, and we have another pole somewhere, and the deviation is not in the vertical direction anymore. Maybe the intersection point, the breakaway point, don't need to be in the middle between the first and the second pole. How can we find the gain K and also the value of the root at that breakaway point, at that breakaway point? We begin from the closed loop characteristic equation 1 plus KGS equal to 0, which means the gain K equal to minus 1 per GS. The gain K is equal to minus 1 per GS. At the breakaway point, at the breakaway point, at the breakaway point, the gain is the maximum gain along the real axis. When the gain is more than that maximum gain, the locus gonna deviate from the real axis. The gain K at the breakaway point, the gain K at the breakaway point is the maximum gain. It's the maximum gain against the S. So the idea that we can obtain the maximum value of gain K is to dip this term K by the S and equal to zero. We're gonna have the maximum point by this way. So by this way, from this equation, the dip of the gain K, the dip of the gain K by the S equal to zero, we're gonna have the gain that relate to the the breakaway point. So from the characteristic equation, we can relate the gain K to the open loop transfer function. So if the problem give the open loop transfer function, and we need to find the breakaway point, we just transform the open loop transfer function into the terms of gain K and dip and make it equal to zero and solve for the S that make the equation true, become true. So deep of deep of this one need to equal to zero. Deep of this one is equal to zero. It means the deep of isn't it? Deep of this one is equal to zero means the denominator gonna be the numerator. The minus sign here is not important, but the deep of this should be zero. The deep of this should be zero. And the deep of this gonna be equal to zero. And the value of the S gonna be minus 16 plus and minus square root. The numerical value gonna be then the root gonna be a complex conjugate. The root gonna be a complex conjugate means when we want to find the breakaway point, we want to find one position, one value of S on the real axis, that the locus of the root move from the real axis. So that S solution, the root, it should be the real value. It should be the completely real number. But in this case, we obtain two root and there are the complex conjugate, which mean with this transfer function, with this open loop transfer function, we don't have the breakaway. In this case, S1 and S2 are not on the real axis. S1 and S2 are not on the real axis. So we don't have the breakaway point, no breakaway. It makes sense because this open loop transfer function, when we plot the root locus, there are two poles as a complex conjugate pole, and there is one pole on the real axis. And this one pole just go along the minus real axis. And we don't need to have the breakaway point. In another example, that we're gonna see the breakaway point. The zero is equal to minus 1.5. the poll gonna be 0 minus 1 and minus 2. The poll gonna be at 0 minus 1 and minus 2. And the 0 gonna be at minus 1.5. And we know that the locus of the root gonna be between the first and the second pole. The locus of the root gonna be on the left hand side of the odd number pole or zero. The odd number pole or zero. In this case, how many asymptotes? How many asymptotes? Asymptote gonna be number of pole subtract by number of zero. We have three pole and have one zero. So we're gonna have two asymptotes. And the two asymptotes gonna be along the plus and minus 90 degree. Plus and minus 90 degree. The locus of the root gonna move from the pole to the zero when we increase the gain K, when we increase the gain K. For this pole, when we increase the gain K, the locus will move from this pole and approach the zero. For these two pole, we don't have the zero for them. We don't have the zero for them, which means the zero gonna be at the infinite. And in which direction of infinite? It's gonna be along the asymptote. So it means it's gonna hit with each other, the pole from the root, the locus from the first pole will go to the left-hand side when we increase gain K. The locus of the root will go to the right-hand side for this pole. And when it hits with each other, it's gonna break away from the real axis and go along the asymptote. If we don't have this part in the system, asymptote gonna be exactly in the middle between the two poles. But in this system, we have this part of the system. And the zero try to add some power to, it's like potential field, something like that. You can consider like that. The zero this is try to pull the locus to this. If you replace this zero by a pole here, the pole is trying to kick the locus away from the pole. But if we have the zero here, the zero try to pull the locus to the zero. So now the asymptote is not exactly in the middle between the two poles anymore. Where is the intersection point of the asymptote? The intersection point of the asymptote is going to be the summation pole subtract by summation zero divided by n minus m. The intersection point for the asymptote. And the angle for the asymptote you can reveal in the topic of the asymptote. So what we need to continue is we need to find the breakaway point. We need to find the breakaway point at this point. There are two points that are important in this picture. The first point is the point that the asymptote cross the real axis. The point that the asymptote cross the real axis. Another point is the breakaway. Another point is the breakaway. We use the same governing equation. I mean, at the breakaway point, it's gonna be the maximum gain. That's still on the real axis. It's gonna be the maximum gain. 1 plus KGS equal to 0, it means K equal to minus 1 per GS. And to find the breakaway point, dK by dS should be equal to 0, which mean d by ds of minus 1 per gs equal to 0. This is gs, the open loop transfer function. We need to switch the numerator and denominator and try to have the product of this term, And we just ignore the negative sign here, So the product of these three factor gonna be S power 3 plus 3 S power 2 plus 2 S this should equal to 0. The dip of this ratio, you may begin from take the denominator and then dip the numerator, dip S power 3, dip S power 2, and dip S, and subtract by, we take the numerator. And we dip the denominator. We dip S equal to 1. And divide by the denominator square. This is gonna equal to 0. So yeah, try to solve the equation, the third order polynomial. Try to solve this equal to 0. Try to solve this equal to 0. Maybe we're gonna have three root because it's the third order polynomial. When I try, I have the first root equal to minus 1.6. Minus 1.6 plus 0.4j. The second one gonna be minus 1.6 minus 0.4j as a complex conjugate. And the last root that I have, the last root that I have is equal to minus 0.54, minus 0.54. There are three possible value of S. There are three possible value of S that make this equation become true. But we already know from this that if the S are not on the real axis, if the S are not on the real axis, we cannot consider that S as the breakaway point. So in this example, there are two root that are not on the real axis, not totally the real number, but only this one is on the real axis, is on the real axis. So in this case, the breakaway point gonna be here. It's not exactly in the middle, 0.5 between the pole. It's not exactly in the middle between the pole, because the effect of the zero here is try to pull everything to the locus of the root to the zero. So it slightly shift to the left due to the effect of the zero. I already mentioned if we switch the order of this pole and zero, if here is the pole, if here is the pole, it's gonna kick the things to the right hand side, and the value for the breakaway point gonna be different, gonna be different. So in this case, the numerical value for the breakaway point gonna be at minus 0.54. Another alternative to get the breakaway point is just create a simple table. We know that the gain K, we know that the gain K is minus 1 per GS. And GS is this one. K equal to minus 1 per GS minus, and switch the numerator and denominator, and try to vary the value of the S. We just want to see that when S equal to minus 0.3, minus 0.4, minus 0.5 along the real axis, when we vary the value of S, what should be the value of the gain K? What should be the value of the gain K? We can see that when we increase from 0.3 to 0.4, of course the gain K increase. Until 0.5, the gain K still increase. But after that, minus 0.6, the gain K slightly decrease. So the S value for maximum value of K, the S for max K is between S equal to 0.5 and S equal to 0.6. You may try to consider minus 0.55 to see the value of the gain K, to see the value of the gain K. The point that can create the max K gonna be the breakaway point. Break in and break away. The meaning is totally different. Totally different means Okay, let's plot the locus of this open loop transfer function. We have zero. We have pole. If we need to plot it here on the S plane, the pole gonna be zero and minus one, and the zero gonna be at minus three. It's gonna be like this. The locus of the root, gonna be between the first and the second pole, and we're gonna have the breakaway point. And if you find the asymptote, of this system, we're gonna have one asymptote. And the direction of the asymptote, gonna be in the 180 degrees, go along this direction. In this case, let me slightly move the position of the zero. In this case, the locus will begin from the pole, right? When gain k equals to zero, the locus of the root will be exactly on the position of the pole. When we increase the gain, one locus will go upper, another locus will go to the lower section, and then it's gonna come back. When it hit with each other here, one will approach the zero, another one will go to the minus infinite. So in this system, we have both breakaway. And we have break in. The nature of the locus is it's gonna be on the left hand side of the first order, third order pole or zero on the real axis, the odd order. So mean it's gonna be here and gonna be here. And when the gain equals to zero, the locus of the root will be exactly on the pole location. And then when we increase the gain k, the root will slightly move away from the pole and try to approach zero. If we have zero at infinite gain k, the locus of the root will be exactly on the zero position. But if we don't have zero, the locus of the root will go along the asymptote, and approach the infinite, the zero at infinite. So in this case, we have two pole and we have one zero. One locus will arrive this zero. Another locus will go to infinite. Infinite in which direction depend on the direction of the asymptote. So when the root hit with each other, one will go upper, one will go in the downward direction, and it will come to approach and hit with each other again. One will go to the right, to the zero. Another one will go to the minus infinite. So where is the exact position of the break-in and the breakaway, of the break-in and the breakaway? For the breakaway point, for the breakaway point, is the max gain K, max gain K on the real axis before it moves away from the real axis. For the break-in point, for the break-in point, it's gonna be the min K, the minimum gain K here. Why I say it's minimum gain K? It's the minimum gain K on the real axis. And when we increase the gain K, when we increase the gain K, the locus of the root will slightly move from the break-in point to the zero and move to the minus infinite. By the way, min K at this point, the K is bigger than the max K on the breakaway. Minimum K at the break-in still bigger than the maximum K at the breakaway point by the physical meaning. But by math, we use the same concept. If we need to obtain the max value or the mean value, we just dip the gain K against the S and equal to zero. It means that you just perform this operation. The dip of the minus one per GS and make it equal to zero. If it have the break in and break away, the solution will show both the break in and break away simultaneously. And you need to consider which one is the break in, which one is the break away. So let's try to solve the derivative of the minus one per GS. Derivative of minus one per GS. Minus one per GS. We can ignore the negative sign. We can ignore the negative sign. But we still need to dip this fraction. So dip this fraction, we keep the denominator. We keep the denominator. And we dip the numerator. We dip the numerator. And then we keep the numerator. And we dip the denominator. And divide by the denominator square equal to zero, which means Okay, so the numerical value gonna be so the value of the break in and break away point, the value of the break in and break away point, it seems like we have the center of the circle. It seems like we have the center of circle at minus three on the real axis. And the radius of the circle, gonna be square root six. The breakaway point here is minus three plus square root six. And the break in gonna be minus three minus square root six. Yeah, you may need to use the calculator to obtain the numerical value of this. I already mentioned in the beginning that we learn how to sketch, but we have computational tools. Here is the first slide that we try to use MATLAB to plot the root locus. This is the open loop transfer function. You compose the variable name sys. Mean the type of the variable is transfer function. You use the function name transfer function. I think we already talked about this in the vibration class, but maybe you already forgot it. Transfer function of num and then in this case num s plus 3 then can be just s square plus s plus 0, right? S square plus s plus 0. Instead of using the poly here, you may compose then by 1 1 0. You can compose then by 1 1 0. Num is 1 3. It means s plus 3. Then is s square plus s plus 0. You can compose then by 1 1 0. But I use the poly. Poly means it's gonna compose the polynomial from the root. For example, if you have the factor like this, and you want to find the polynomial from this, you may use the poly function and the array and put the root here. The order is not important. The first root is minus 1. The second root is minus 2. The third root is minus 3. And by use the poly, you're gonna have the product of this. So in this case, I use poly because the polynomial is the polynomial of s minus 0 multiplied by s minus minus 1. So the poly, I use poly function to compose the polynomial for the denominator, The important part that you need to confirm is if you put the semicolon here, you are not going to see the sixth variable. But if you just leave it open, MATLAB gonna show you the results of the variable named sixth that you try to compose by using the transfer function And it's the same, right? So the open loop transfer function is the same. The new function for you that I'm going to introduce is the command rlocus. Rlocus mean root locus. Rlocus of the transfer function of sys is gonna plot this one immediately. Rlocus sys is gonna plot this immediately. The grid gonna show the damping ratio. When the damping ratio equal to 1, the line, the radial line will go along the negative real axis. If the damping ratio equal to 1, if the damping ratio is less than 1, you see, they show the decrease of damping ratio. When damping ratio is 0, the thing's gonna move along the imaginary axis. So by the analytical way, we solve for the breakaway point and the break-in point, the breakaway and break-in. You will try to use calculator to obtain the numerical value, and you can confirm with this value. This value means the pole will be at this point. The imaginary part is very small. It's very small. Zero imaginary part. The break-in and breakaway point, The break-in and breakaway point need to be on the real axis. Actually, imaginary part should be zero, but I click the point on the plot and yeah, it shows some very small value of this. I already told you that everything on the real plane, no, on the real axis. You see the damping ratio on the real axis, the damping ratio is equal to 1. Damping ratio equal to 1 can guarantee 0% of the overshoot. 0% of the overshoot. No overshoot for step. It can guarantee the 0% of overshoot. At the other damping ratio, maybe it can show some percent of the overshoot. The gain K that relate to the break in and break away, the gain K, I'm not quite sure about this, but yeah, I already told you that, you know, for the breakaway, we try to find the maximum gain that's still on the real axis. When the gain is more than that maximum gain, it will stay away. If you go over from the real axis. But the meaning of the break-in is it's the minimum gain that it already approached the real axis, but you still can increase the gain. You still can increase the gain, but it will be on the real axis. The minimum gain that it start to approach the real axis, the maximum gain that is still be on the real axis. But if you consider the value of the gain, you see, max gain that is still on the real axis is 0.1. And then you increase the gain, the root will travel. And when your gain is 9.9, when your gain is 9.9, it's gonna come back to the real axis, come back to the real axis. Okay, so tired. let's have maybe 10 minute break before we continue. We're gonna have a few more MATLAB example. So please come back in 10 minutes. What? Thank you.